cheap day that they usually pay the speaker, but since I was here, I spent 10 hours looking at the defense and wondering whether I get bouquet or flag or ticket to it on the speaker. But the thing that I have this morning to combine with the church's thing, people don't plan to fail. They just fail to plan. And I want you to think about that before I begin my special guest lecture here. And I want you to think about this poem. It's called Road Home. And on the fourth Sunday, which was Communion Sunday at my church growing up in the big city of Tuskegee, our pastor would say this poem over and over again during communion service. We'd be a driving eye in the house. So the poem goes like this. Lord, is this the right road home? Yes, child. Yes, child. Yes, child. Is this the right road home? The clouds are dark and steel. The stony path so sharp and hard. Each step brings some fresh hill. Lord, is this the right road home? Yes, child. Yes, child. Yes, child. Is this the right road home? I thought the way would brighter road. And that the sun would warm, would grow. And joyous songs from free hearts follow. Tell me, Lord, is this the right road home? Yes, child. Yes, child. Yes, child. This is the right road home. The clouds were dark for me. The stony path so sharp and hard. Not sight, but faith to see. That at the end, the sun shines bright forever, for there is no night. And glad hearts rest from earth's fierce fight. Lord, is this the right road home? Yes, child. Yes, child. Yes, child. This is the right road home. Back to our theme, retooling Dexter for the challenges of the 21st century. And I had a chance to be a member of Bible Study Fellowship, to be a member of the church all my life, and to be a member of the public school setting, to be able to mesh those theories together, develop my own practice, and been successful in the past by making sure my students had a plan. I grew up on the worst street back then in Tuskegee. We grew up on the road with 13 little guys, and 10 of them are dead now. I think I just turned 50. I might be 50. But they're dead, and three of those graduated high school, including me. But they were disobedient. We were disobedient, bad boys. We came from single-parent mothers. The crack house was on our street, and the bootlegger house. But my mother would always tell me, I had five old sisters and they always keep their thumbs. But when she would wash her dishes in the winter, she would tell me, son, don't go too far to the right and don't go too far to the left. She had a plan for it. She said, as long as you can hear my voice and I can see you, I can help you. But when you get out of the earshot of my voice or my eyes, she said, I can't help you. She said, so pay attention. So the first lesson in my curriculum and supervision class that I teach my master's students, and they always seem to get a little upset because, you know, in the world, it's an arrogant. I say, you need to remember Eric Erickson. The first thing is a good teacher, we know we learn in psychology. You have to teach your class to pay attention and obey. And if they don't master that, no matter what you teach, they're not going to be receptive to what you're doing. So my mother, all that I am, and all that I hope to become, always my mother, because she had the hand of God on her to teach me. And in the 10th, I think the 8th grade, all my friends, the ones I told you, dropped out of 7th grade. And my mother said, what are you going to do this morning? You going to drop out? I said, that's one of my plans. I'm going to get a job at the gas station. Change tires. They don't even change tires anymore, but I was going to be changing tires, man, paying $25 a week. Y'all were promised me that job in 8th grade. I'm big one.
Right.
And And I had five other sisters, they couldn't deal with me, they were dangerous time for young people.
That's right.
You know, in elementary school, young people spend 100% of their time cleaning the office. Middle school, they spend 50% of their time cleaning the fields. And don't let high school be used. They spend 100% of their time cleaning the friends and fields. So I told her I'm going home, and that's it, she did her best move on, and I was paying attention, and she started crying. She said, "You big boy, you kid." She said, "Stay in school one more year, play football, basketball." I said, "My heart don't like school." She said, "What is my school like?" "The teachers are not your teachers. The principals are not family." I said, "They treat the middle class kids and the university class kids better than they treat me because we're from the wrong time." She said, "Well, you go back to school for me." I said, "Okay, I'll go." But as I watched the organization of the school, and I began to pray, I said, "Lord, please help me to find a way to help those 10 more that they got lost." Well, I prayed for you, and the old people say, "Just pray, Lord. Just keep praying, keep praying." I said, "Okay." He'll pray one day, he came. You know, I said, "What do you want, boy?" I said, "Well, can I help other boys develop the skills?" 8th grade, 13, 14 years old. To be able to help other boys. I don't want to be good. I don't want to wait for the NACP, the city of Tuskegee, the church, the Boy Scouts, the Cubs. I've got involved in all that. 4-H. You know the name of come people, football player, basketball player, baseball player. They were always coming to me. I said, "I don't want to be involved, and I want to do it in a public school." He said, "What I'll show you. And help you do it, learn those skills. No one will see. No one will believe where you came from. And no one will understand that you lead along the way." So I've been fortunate to be a turnaround principal. Where every job I got, somebody called me for it. Every time I was doing it, I obtained my scholarship from a doctor, somebody just called me. So I knew it wouldn't be. I asked him to help, but he said he would help me. Humble myself. Paid attention, knew it for. I was a teacher down in the country when I first started teaching. And I would tell people, I told them in this last week, I said, I sent over 300 students. I mean, so you keep saying you did. I know it's power through the Spirit of God and prayer. But I was a shop teacher, so we were class always overloaded in the shop. I had 40 students in a class, 5 period days. With these kids, they don't have a vision.
Well,
see, we don't have a vision of people perish. And we worked with Boy Scouts and 4-H, we brought in 4-H program where the students had to have identified occupation they wanted to participate in. And it could be a rapper, it could be a singer, it could be a pro football player, you know, because all my male role models in the past from Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, baseball, football, high school coach wouldn't allow me to put that down in Alabama as an occupation. You had to have a real job.
That's right.
So the pastor said, "We're going to do our men's day worship this year in a book called The Man in the Mirror." I kind of smiled when he said that. But what I was looking at for them to understand that they want to be a banker. You want to be a school teacher. Mm-hmm. If you want to be a dentist and a certain sound. Come up. So, and so we know they like to call up the nice winds and the radio. So we said, "Pick a car you want. Pick a car. It's over 80% of that budget." I said, "Now that budget is left before each person would explain to them, or the person we had mentoring them, we'd bring a teacher, we'd bring a banker, we'd bring it again. They would explain that you only have 20% left for your rent. Now what kind of house you want to live in?" I had thought. So they were 9th graders. I got their attention, and I made them obey. And I know I could do that too because my physical stature is a little bit better, but also they don't care about me. Then we they begged me one day, the next thing I said, "We want to start a fraternity and sorority." I said, "My standard's too high for you. You wouldn't want to do my voice, get to seek out the other men, and they'll let you do it." And I said, "You have to have a 3.0 to be in anything I would be involved in." I said, "That's including the female come in the morning or once a week and dress different. You need to be set apart. All of these different activities I learned in church from my mother and from men and women in the community coming back, helping us, being role models. But we keep talking about retooling for the 21st century. But look at the family has been destroyed. And we have to be role models and go back into these schools. So as I teach my students, I teach them to put in that curriculum what we call the 21st century skills. So we've got our students need to learn how to think critically, critical thinking skills.
That's right.
Number two, they need to understand how to be creative. They need to understand how you use that power of creativity. They need to understand the power of communication. They say, if you can't write now, that's the new part. Students that can't write a complete sentence. Students who cannot write a complete thought or paragraph. Students that don't know how to collaborate. That's the fourth. They don't know how to collaborate and ask for help. All these are one-on-one, but when you don't have a vision, you don't think that's important. And I remind my students again, I say, again, you have to pay attention and aware, because I'm creating future principles. In these schools, and I created principals all over the state, some in Georgia. But I told myself, the next thing you need to understand, the society you live in, we live in a great state. I said, we live in a black belt, and I'm going to tell you what it is, and wake up again, make a half time going in back out. I said, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Arkansas, Louisiana, are the black belt. But Alabama is the bulk. They can't stay on you if the book is not fully functioning. So you need to understand, Alabama got the 1901 Constitution, Alabama, with color showing, and poor white children don't have a right to education. It's been revised, so everything they do every time, you call it proration. You get three teachers in, a good teacher, your new teacher, you be a good teacher, but they won't pay attention.
They won't be okay.
They gonna do the lesson plan, they gonna be on time, they gonna try to press the key. By the time you get them set, proration hit in that budget. Every 3 years in Alabama, you have to cut all your new teachers. So every time you get a new budget, you still stick with the old teachers who don't get it, who not against it. So you got a system set up where the finances dictate total destruction of what you're trying to deal with. So you have to be prepared to understand what you're up against. I say you have to have a succession plan.
Alright.
We don't do that at our school, we don't do that at our universities. When I was at Alabama State Law Campus Program, I worked for Miles College tonight, Alabama State, I'm liaison at Alabama State doing their master's program now. In Mobile and Bishop State, I would work with them. We would work with Tuskegee University, we would work with ASU Southern Norman Roots. I got a chance to understand the psychology and deal with people. Because I always tell my students, you can't teach a cook from a book, so you have to be a person that understands conflict resolution and be able to go in and deal with people, talk with people. I teach 21st century people. I say you have to understand the buddy-buddy system. It's killing our community. Now people get mad and they say, Dr. Some of my students are even going to be black or poor whites, and my poor whites still say when you say they're not poor white, but I say when you get all down, that's the money's catered to. You're not considered poor white. That's where the money is. That's the flagship university. So I said, listen to the moral to the story, don't tell you anything personal. All right. But succession planning and buddy-buddy says, oh, we are open up a position for new paths. But so-and-so's son is a pastor, and we're going to make him pastor. We don't open it up and set criteria and really open it up. Alfonso needs the principal job. It's their turn to be principal. Mm-hmm. It's their turn to be superintendent.
All right.
Never saying that this person has a skill set.
All right.
And he said, you'll know them by the fruit. And we'll say, well, what you mean? Do you have anybody? When they got their certificate, they have this pastor.
Come
on. I said, well, you know a man by the fruit, you look at the lives he built. Or you look at the lives he destroyed behind confusion. All you do is look at his resume and tell you who that man or woman is. But we want to do the buddy-buddy system. And for 50 years, we walked in a circle.
Well,
and I was a poor woman.
It's an 11-day journey to the promised land.
And you walk in that sand.
That's right.
The Israelites are 50 years, we go in the sand. We have to wake up and understand what our plan is, where we're going, and actions produce consequences. I won't keep you long, I told you, the past hour will be short and sweet, but if we look at our lesson background in Matthew 19:1-22, we break down our homily in four major areas. Jesus answered the question about the divorce. Jesus welcomed little children. We don't welcome little children. But y'all were warned you about playing around with little children. And he said, Jesus revealed the rich young man's true love. What is our true love? And we need to be mindful of that when we go out. We want you to learn that Jesus calls his followers to live unselfishly and to commit to him fully. Live unselfish lives and run the race that he wants you to run. The Pharisees were old men like me now. I'm old when I can admit it, but they were old men like their 40s or 50s. You could be a Pharisee or a Sadducee. A young man, Jesus, young man, they followed Jesus 50 miles to try and track. So they came up Jesus as humbly as they always did. They snake always do your last teeth before they try to track. And they asked him, they said, Jesus, what did they do? And they asked him this question about divorce. He was going to alienate 50% of the people. Either way, so they would divide and conquer. And that's a strategy we all use. They divide and conquer. That's the only strategy in our toolbox. And when you only have one, if you only have a hammer in your toolbox, every problem looks like a nail. So they said they were going to nail this boy down. And they ain't going to give us an answer. Young boy, who is that boy? 3 years old. He said, God intended marriage to be one man and
woman. I'm real good. I'm a Pharisee with smart people. Books.
But they had no revelation of God. They didn't have that relationship. And the pastor talked about us developing a relationship. That's marriage. You have a relationship with a man or a woman. And if you're not married, we're talking about the real description, good deed. Some people married to Jesus, and that's not the way. But some people who get in a relationship so important, he said, if you get a divorce, it'd be like cutting off a limb. They said, well, Moses allowed us to have a bill of divorce. He said, who is Moses? Jesus asked, who is Moses? He said, the man, he's our father. Again, he asked, who is Moses? God only allowed divorce. He said, if you do that and marry another who got a divorce, who did not get a divorce based on adultery, you live in adultery. And the punishment will come to the parents. Going back to where I came from. And the punishment will go back to the children. You will wonder why chaos resides in America. In Alabama, wherever we may be, or in our community now. Because we live in adultery's lives. If we not care for the faithful to what we do and who we marry and relationships that we carry out. Jesus had been preaching again for in the mountains where he had sat down 5,000 and told Peter and all of the 12 disciples to sit down. 5,000 means I gotta watch the men.
Yes.
The 12,000 women she don't run like said, sit the men, I gotta watch all of them, watch the women. And he fed them all again. The disciples were upset when Jesus was late in the afternoon. They said, sit down, hungry. He said, no, we have compassion for them. I'm going to feed them. I gave them the word. He said, I'm going to feed them, and then I'm going to send them home. But they want to send them only home with the Spirit, with the word. So we have to feed our people and teach them how to feed before we send them home.
That's right.
So as Jesus was coming back again, the children wanted to see Jesus. The parents wanted their kids to see so he could bless them and heal them. And Peter and Paul and John and James, they were doing their best, but they were selfish. He said, you all done him? They didn't want them people in that time. They liked their children. Still don't know.
And they didn't like women being in charge or being out with the men.
So Jesus said, let those little children die.
And the disciples were sick. Again, looking at the relationship, do we have compassion? Do we have relationships with what we do?
Jesus said, say to those children, I said, how do we get him? The little child, he said, until you become humble, pay attention to him. Like one of these little children. And that's the way to deal. And if you harm anyone, then we wonder why chaos and harm and children.
Setting up systems that harm children and brings chaos in our community. And again, we too for the 21st century. How do we go from point A to point B?
If we look at the rich young man who would soon be the Pharisee, because he said, I obeyed all the commandments. Now this is realistic. See, the Pharisees were so small and clever.
Like that, I didn't even want to talk.
Jesus only made 10 commandments. God only made 10 commandments. The Pharisees were so clever, they made 613.
They put a burden on and said, I'm self-righteous, I'm better than you. And Jesus warned them, don't do what the Pharisees do, but do what they say. We have to be obedient to our rules. That's why we have to have a plan. But he said, be obedient. But he said, don't do what they do. So sometimes in church, we have people in church on jobs. They'll tell you to do something one way, but they do it totally different. We have to understand our relationships. We have to understand our commandments. But he said he had obeyed all 613 commandments. Now, we know that nobody heard. So he could have done, so he really was a Pharisee. But let's look at our 10 commandments before we go on. He said, I am your God. Number one, he said, worship only God. Number three, keep God's name holy. Number four, keep the Lord's day special. Number five, always obey your dad and mom. Number six, thou shalt not murder. Number seven, be faithful in marriage. Number eight, not steal. Number nine, never tell a lie. And number 10, do not be jealous of what others have.
That's right.
Now he summarized those for the young Pharisee. He said, which one is the greatest commandment of all? Pharisee, young Pharisee, being no young rich man. He said, to love God with all your heart. All your land. All your soul. He said, all your strength. You love all your strength and your finances. But we don't want to do that. We say, oh, paying tithe whole chest. And he told him, when he saw him, pay your temple. They went on and he closed out and asked him about paying the seeds. And he said, give me that corn. Whose head is on that corn? He said, seize me. He said, run down his seeds. Well, his seeds is then paying God his This is in the New Testament, folks. The preachers get confused. That's the Old Testament. When you come and you study the Word, humble yourself. Pay attention and obey. He'll teach the Word to you so that you can go out into the valley and carry the good news.
That's right.
And when we look at retooling for the challenges of the 21st century, it's basically the same. But when we allow our families to live in confusion and chaos, when we don't deal and succession planning, and making sure we put the most qualified people in our schools, and put the most qualified people in our churches to preach the word, then that's called self-inflicted wound. So let's make sure that we become a people that are planning to fail. They just fail to plan.
God bless you.
And I want to thank you all for listening to me and giving me some time today. Thank you, Pastor, for being in the deep.